take a journey, as Michelle said. We'll start off with Domenico Scarlatti, a Baroque composer. I'll play two of his keyboard sonatas. Scarlatti is an Italian composer, or was an Italian composer. He was born in Naples, which belonged to Spanish crown back then. So he actually worked at the Spanish, for the Spanish royalty most of his life. Wrote in various musical forms, but he's mostly known for his keyboard sonatas that he composed. 555.
Wow.
Lots of songs. Short and not very long, but a lot of music. I will play two of his sonatas. Both are in a minor key. The reason I chose these sonatas is very simple. I really like them. They're a little bit melancholic, but they really speak to you, I think, speak to your soul. Really sensual pieces and transporting in a way, like imagine Scarlatti living like late 17th century, like Spain, Italy, and the life and how it was, and bohemia of it and everything. So they're really beautiful pieces, and please enjoy. So let's start with Scarlatti.
Thank you.
Next two pieces are composed by Frédéric Chopin, Polish-French composer. Slightly more than half of his life he lived in Poland, but when he was in his early 20s, I believe, he fled Poland due to Russian-Polish war, and went to West to pursue his career farther and also to get away from the conflict. He was always a frail man, never in the best health. He died quite young. He was 39 when he passed away. He died in Paris. Quite a sad life, and I think it's reflected in his music. He had this terrible longing for his homeland always. He never ended up going back after he left. He had his family there, however. Actually, the piece I'm going to play next, the Scherzo in B minor. This piece was written right after he had left Poland, and the Russian-Polish war was still in the process, and his family was back in Poland. And you can really see in the piece the turmoil, the career, but the homeland, the family, so many things. It's a dark piece, very dark piece. Starts out huge forte in the upper register, and then another huge forte in the lower register, and like almost like a demonic. You can definitely hear it in that first part of the piece. In the second part, you kind of go into this more mellow mood. That's, in my opinion, I think it's almost like consoling on his situation. You know, and the reality is not good, but he's sort of, you know, maybe everything will be good. And actually the theme of the second part is a Polish lullaby. So kind of, you know, maybe a futile, but he's trying to console himself, maybe everything's gonna be okay. But then the reality sets in right at the end of this second part, and you're transported back to the reality. And it ends that way. So let's hear it. Thank you. warm up. Hands were a little cold. You can definitely hear the darkness, I think, in this piece. The second piece is a contrasting piece, to say the least. It's a shorter piece. It's a nocturne by Chopin, and it's from the posthumous opus, meaning it was first published about, I think, quarter century later, after his death, after he passed away. However, it was composed about eight or nine years before he died. It's a nocturne in C sharp minor. However, it's oftentimes referred as a reminiscence on life, its ups and downs, failures, triumphs, and the end. And for me personally, this piece has it all, I think. It starts on a minor sonority, but then it explores all sorts of major sonorities, very humoresque type of, there's a little humoresque type of section there. So I think it's very, very full of experiences and contrasting characters. And then you come back to this kind of this nostalgic and like sad mood again. I think Chopin was just known for that. It's a very sad composer. But the ending is very interesting. I would urge you to look out for the end. It's a very interesting ending. It's a sad piece overall, but it has a good end, I think. And I mean, I don't know what it means. Thank you. the ending. Major ending. It's a good ending. The next in our program, we have two Russian composers, Alexander Scriabin and Sergei Rachmaninov. I love Rachmaninov very much. He's a very, very interesting man. So was Alexander Scriabin. We'll have Scriabin first in the program and then we'll play Rachmaninov. Alexander Scriabin was a Russian composer, very interesting man, due to the fact that he has two stages of composition output. First stage was very much tonal, very tonally dominated. It's said that Chopin was a great inspiration for Scriabin, and sometimes he's referred to as a Russian Chopin. It has that melancholy, very sensual sonorities. Second part of his compositional output, when he probably after his 20s, so he got more mature, went very much atonal. And it's important to point out that it was independent of Arnold Schoenberg, which was a pioneer of, he was a great tonal composer himself, but he abandoned it for a 12-tone system that he created himself, pioneered it, championed it, and so many people followed him afterwards. Scriabin was very much different, and that's why he's so important, I think, that he did this independent of Schoenberg, and he didn't really have any system to go atonal. It was very unique. Schoenberg had a very specific set of rules how you could write 12-tone music. Scriabin is very much in his own sort of space and world. The piece I'm going to play for you today is from his first stage compositional output. It's a tonal piece, and Scriabin was a teenager when he composed it, actually. Very impressive, if you ask me. This piece was one of the reasons he actually became quite famous, because as a teenager he wrote really, really good music. This piece is called an etude in C sharp minor. And it's a slow piece. So when you hear an etude, you think of this virtuosity, everything. But it's very much a virtuosic piece in a different sense, musically speaking. It's a very difficult piece to master musically. There are a lot of repeated chords, and to bring out the melody, the inner melodies, to make sure it's not dull. It's not boring, too repetitive. It's a big challenge, big challenge. Hence the name Etude. I think that's what Scriabin was referring to when he named the piece Etude. So let's hear. Thank you. next piece is by Sergei Rachmaninoff, a musical moment in E minor. Rachmaninoff was a great, great Russian composer. He actually spent some of his life in the United States. I believe he left Russia during the Russian Revolution in 1918. I mentioned Soviet Union right earlier, so that was the beginning of it. He came to the United States in 18 or 19 and settled in New York first. I think he was in his 40s already, so he was an established composer. He had composed a great deal of music. Later in his life, he actually moved to California, Beverly Hills. He died in Beverly Hills. An interesting fact is, he was granted U.S. citizenship a month before he died. So I don't know if it means anything, but it's just an interesting fact. You know. The piece I'm going to play by Rachmaninoff, he wrote it in his 20s, so he lived in Russia. And he wrote this piece. And there's an interesting story behind them. It's a set of six pieces. They meant to represent sort of a musical form from the past, from the tradition. Each represents a different sort of musical form and character. Rachmaninoff wrote these pieces because he got robbed, I think. And he was in urgent need of money, and he had other projects. Much bigger pieces. He really needed some money to, I don't know, pay bills or whatever. And he somehow managed to get this commission to write six pieces. I have to point out that it's not reflected. The pressing issue is not reflected in the music. It's a great music, and some of Rachmaninoff's actually most performed pieces too. So it's interesting. It's an interesting factor. Piece by itself, it's in E minor. Very much resembles the Chopin's revolutionary etude, very much left dominant, technically speaking, very virtuosic left hand, and this very lush Rachmaninoff melody in the right hand. And it's a difficult piece, technically speaking, and musically too. So I actually recently learned this piece this month, so I'm excited to play it. Thank you. Next piece is, we're approaching, actually, if you notice, we're approaching our present time. Rachmaninov was early 20th century. Now we'll play a piece by a Georgian composer. Most likely you haven't heard of him. He's a prominent Soviet composer, late 20th century. Nodar Gabunia is his name. He passed away. However, he was an important composer, because just like Béla Bartók for Hungarian folk music, he graduated Moscow Conservatory. He studied with greats of composition, piano. He was very educated in Western tradition, but he wanted to sort of draw this inspiration from the Georgian folk music, which is a very rich tradition, very polyphonic, goes back before Christ, before a lot of things, and very, just as a side thing, if you're curious, if you like folk music, check out Georgian folk, quite something. Very, if you like polyphonic music. And he really tried to capture this material, this musical material, and sort of bring it into this westernized setting, but not ruin it and not change it too much. So the piece I'm going to play for you is an attempt of that. And you can really hear these fifths, perfect fifths, a lot of perfect fifths. It's very prominent in Georgian folk music, a lot of perfect fifths. And it's a microtonal music, so there are certain intervals in the folk music that cannot really be transported to piano. This is the best attempt of his to really capture that music and bring it for piano. It's called Dedication. It was dedicated to one of his friends. It's a really, really beautiful piece. And one of the few Georgian pieces I play, I have in my repertoire. So I'm really looking forward to playing it. Hope you enjoy it. I think we've arrived to the present, and the next piece is actually a piece composed by me. And I'm here. however, this piece is a pre-composed piece. This is not a live composition or an attempt. I've been working on it for a few weeks, maybe a little more than a month. But I don't know, for a creative person, you know, there's some days and there were weeks that I didn't add to it because I just didn't feel it, didn't feel right. I don't know. But it's done, and I wanted to compose something for this event, actually, for Michelle's salon concert. I haven't named it yet, but it will be a debut today.
Perhaps we could name it for you. Michelle. Michelle.
I do want to say a few things about this piece. You know, when I thought of composing something, you, as an artist, as a musician, you always look inside first, I think. And my life has been a kind of a roller coaster. I mean, just like everyone else, I guess. But, you know, there were a few defining moments in my life, I would say, that really, you know, sometimes a bad thing can happen in your life, but it's a good thing. One of my favorite quotes is, every problem is an opportunity in disguise. And I really like to look at things that way. And the funny thing is, I think Robert De Niro said that, you know, artist's life is hard, but if it wasn't hard, what would you draw the inspiration from? So I think somehow it's true in a way that when I want to get inspired, I always look back at certain experiences I had that really put a mark on me, and the things come to me. I think this piece is very much of what I would sit if I was alone and there was no light here and it was all quiet, and I would sit down and I would play and I would enjoy it myself, and it would be my consolation in a way. So I hope you can hear that, and maybe you could feel the same way. You know, not to relate to.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And continuing on that path, I don't even know how I feel now, but I did promise to compose something this part, so I guess I have to do it. So I'll do it. And I think I am inspired enough. So I'll play a composition. I will basically create it this moment. Unlike some may say it's an improvisation, and yes, you're not totally wrong. But if you think about it, improvisation is where do you see it? Most of the time, you see in the jazz, and it's usually it has a structure, and you compose or you improvise around that structure, certain chord progressions, or even you know little parts or certain melody that you take and then you build on it. I think what I will do, there's nothing. It's a clean slate. It could be bad. It's never been so far. I've done this many times, but I'm usually satisfied with the results. But it's a warning.